Hello and welcome to Newsnight, where we speak to major league players in Nigeria's democracy and the issues generated from its drive for growth and development. I am Ladi Akeredolu-Ale. Thanks for being with us. The Nigerian police force in recent years has had quite a bit to chew on, from banditry to kidnapping and then cattle rustling, as well as illegal mining in different parts of the country, as well as conflicts over the force's position on checkpoints, as well as the treating of gunshot victims without a police report, and then the introduction of vigilante groups like Amotekun. The police was front and center. How does it score itself in terms of tackling insecurity? What's its position on the treating of victims with gunshot wounds by medical institutions, as well as the vexed issue of checkpoints nationwide? Newsnight talks to the Inspector General of the Nigerian Police Force, Mohammed Adamu. Inspector General of Police, thank you for your time. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
Many Nigerians, or indeed many people across the world, tend to think of the police only when they get into trouble. Under normal circumstances, the police does not come up. Do you think that is a problem, that in Nigeria, many people don't talk about the police, they don't look out for the police, except they are in trouble?
Well, as you observed, police all over the world is created to make sure that they take care of the society in terms of maintaining law and order, in terms of enforcing existing law within the society. When you have deviants who are always desirous of going against the law, so the society tend to look at police as an organization that should protect them, whether they're in terms of whether they're in distress or in peace. They know that there are some people called police officers around looking after them. In terms of peace, they don't so much notice the presence of police because they know the police are doing their work. That tends to make members of the public to go about their normal duties. But when they are distressed, they are in distress, that is when they now realize that there are some group of people that are supposed to protect them, then because of that distress, they now get back to them and then call them to intervene in whatever situation. So in every society at all, for peace to reign, for law and order, there must be police within that society. You may have a society without even the military, because the peace is so, the peace is there that conflicts are not noticed, so you may not even need the military. But police, because in every aspect of life, whether you like it or not, you must have deviants who will want to go out of the normal way of life in order to cause distress for other members of the society. So there must be a group of people that will bring them back to order, to say within our society we have law and order, we have laws that must be obeyed. And for you to go against the law, you must answer for it. That's why police is needed.
I asked that question to start off with because of the issue of how policemen or women are, their welfare, their well-being, and so on. Society expects the police to protect them, as you pointed out. But the police, as well as other security forces, expect to be properly treated for them to be able to do their jobs. Do you think the way the Nigerian society takes a look at the police, it is doing that? That's why I started with that question when I said what I said. Do you think the society looks at the police and says, ah, there are gaps here, this needs to be done, we need to do this for the police? Do you see that?
Yeah, in Nigeria, it is just like in any other society, it exists. When you create an organization, that organization must have, the law creating it. And when you have the law creating it, it gives areas, it gives the do's and don'ts and the logistical requirement as a platform for that organization to function. The same thing with the police. When you have police as an organization that is supposed to fight crime, to maintain law and order, that organization, the personnel of that organization must be properly trained, they must be properly equipped, they must be given the necessary tools that is required for them to perform the functions for which they are recruited. And in a society like ours, as you pointed out, people are seeing loopholes here and there. Nigerians in different states, we see that the police officers that we have in those states that are operating, the resources that are required to sustain them to do their work are not sufficient. That's why you see some state governors coming in to fill the gap. Some members of the community are also coming up to fill the gap. Because one, our population is big. The number of policemen we have is not enough, though we have the largest police structure, not only the structure, the largest number of police
officers and men
that you can have in the whole of Africa. We have the largest. And the resources we have are not sufficient to cater for this number of officers. That's why other group of people come in to support and fill the gap. But is that again enough? It is not enough because of the challenges that we face. The nature of crime we have now has turned to a different thing. It's so dynamic. In the past, we never had much issues with cyber crime, but now it's rampant. In the past, we never had easy means of communication through social media. Now we have it. And what comes out of social media could be positive and could be negative. Sometimes it creates more environment for crime to be committed. Because when you send in fake news there, it generates bad blood between a group of people, and then you see people reacting. So up to now, we have gaps here and there because of insufficiency of resources. And at the same time, some group of Nigerians that are refusing to understand what policing is all about. There are some group of Nigerians that would want to always have their way. Even if what they are doing they know is wrong, they have committed crime, and then their processes are put in place to punish them, you see them resisting here and there. So there are gaps here and there that needs to be filled. Just like in any other society, whether advanced or less advanced society, those challenges and gaps are still there. Our ability to make use of what we have in order to achieve the purpose for which police is created, that is to fight crime, maintain law and order, our ability to make use of the limited resources, what makes us a different set of police in the world. Because it is only in Nigeria that you have police officers that don't have the required logistics that they need to operate, but they struggle and make the society peaceful. But when you take them out of the country to an international environment where those logistics that are required for you to do policing job are there, you see them performing wonderfully well. And that's why Nigerian police officers are acclaimed to be the best in the world, because you put Nigerian police officers side by side with even police officers from advanced countries, give them the same function, give them the same logistics, you see the officers from the Nigerian police performing better than those that are coming from so-called advanced country. I'm an example. A lot of police officers from those advanced countries worked under me, and I directed them on what policing is and what should come out of them.
In that case, would you say, therefore, that because since then, when you mentioned the kind of people that you talked about, those who don't want due process, who don't want things to happen the way they ought to happen, the way the laws have been put in place, do you then think that those who are saying that the police force should be broken down, that we shouldn't have one central police force, we should have state police, local police, what we used to have as native authority police in some parts and so on, that will make the job of policing easier? And it seems as if you may have bought into it, I don't know if that's true, to the extent that there's a special constabulary that has just been set up. Is that along these lines? Is your thinking along those lines?
When you look at the nature of policing we have, every country has its own style based on its own political structure. In some countries we have centralized police, and some countries we have decentralized. In those countries that have decentralized police, there are countries that their political system and the institutions they have are functioning, they're strong and functioning, and they're able to take care of both decentralized policing system.
Right.
Where you have a country that has county police, you have
city police,
then you have federal police. If you look at their political structure, it's so strong that all these creations are heavily supported. But if you look at some other climes where such political structures are not that strong to maintain that kind of decentralization, they go for central policy, especially in the climb or like ours, where we have different ethnic groups. We don't have a kind of one unique group
that binds
with the
everybody.
Same with culture and the rest of them. Ours is that of different languages, so many cultures, so many affiliations. We have centralized police. And this centralized police takes care of many issues that would have, if allowed, would have created more problems in the country than bringing law and order. So we have in Nigeria national police, one central police. But that one central police, it is only the authority that is central in terms of command and control. But in terms of operations, it is not centralized. It is decentralized. In terms of decision making, it is decentralized. We have 36 state commands with FCT. In each of those commands, we have commissioners of police with his own lieutenants. The sole responsibility of law and order rests with the commissioner of police in that command, not with the IG, because constitutionally, every state must have a commissioner of police. And that commissioner of police works with the government in that state. It's like the commissioner of police and his lieutenants are meant for the governor or the government of that state. So he holds meetings with the governor of the state on security situation in the state, and the governor gives directives on what to be done. Though he is posted from the headquarters, but decision on policing rests with him and the governor. That is a kind of decentralization of function. Not only that, at the local government level, there are DPOs, divisional police officers, whose responsibility is to take care of the local government security. And they relate with the chairman of the local government. So decision on how to go about fighting crime within the local government rests with the DPO and the chairman of the local government. That is another form of decentralization. We went further to say that policing is about the community. If the community buys into what you do, or they tell you this is how we want you to police our community, it is better than you as a DPO or commissioner of police deciding how to police a community. So the idea of community policing now came about, which means at the district level, at the ward level, you have people that came from that community, that were born from that community, they grew up from that community, and they're still staying within that community. We pick them and train them and send them back to the community to work with the traditional rulers of that community, with religious leaders of those communities, with town union leaders of those communities and other stakeholders in identifying the problems associated with those communities that will lead to the commission of crimes and criminality. And they will sit down and propose solutions, steps to be taken to prevent the commission of such crime. Or you have visitors or foreigners, let us not say foreigners, some other non-indigenous of that community coming into that community, and automatically they will be known that these are people that don't belong to the community. And if they are doing activities that will lead to commission of crime, these community policing officers will have the ability to get information, inform the leadership of the community, for the leadership to intervene. This has nothing to do with DPO, going to police station to make a report of cases. Cases, low-level cases, are solved within the community through these community policing officers. It is when a serious crime is committed, a felonious crime is committed, then DPO will come in, because the community policing officers now cannot handle it. A serious matter, case of murder, for example. Then the DPO will have to come in and do the investigation, and then the commissioner of police will do the investigation. So the structure we have in the Nigeria police today, yes, we have a federal police, centralized police, but when it comes to functions and decision making, it is not centralized. The commissioners of police have the ability to take decisions on their own to protect the territory of the state they are managing, in order to prevent crime, in order to maintain law and order. The same thing with the DPOs. And even to tell you that decentralization of Nigeria police for the benefit of the community is what makes policing easier. The national, we used to have one central force criminal investigation department, the force CID, which is in Abuja. So cases that there are certain category of cases that state cannot handle, it has to be escalated to the federal, to force CID level. But it is difficult for Nigerians to be coming to Abuja for cases at the force CID. So Mr. President decided to decentralize the activities of the force CID so that Nigerians will have it easy to report cases. So force CID now has annexes all over the country. If you go to Lagos, we have an annex there. You go to Southeast, we have one in Enugu. If you go to Northeast, we have one in Gombe. If you go Northwest, we have in Kaduna. The idea is that cases that force CID Abuja should handle shouldn't come to Abuja from those geopolitical zones. They should go to those
zonal annexes.
That's right, so that they be closer to the people.
Now, as you were talking, of course, what was going on in my head was that I was imagining, especially when you talked about gathering intelligence and feeding to the authorities at the various levels to be able to take action, even in the prevention of crime and all of that. How does the police, how is it expected to relate to bodies like Amotek, for example, in the Southwest, and other such bodies in the zonal areas?
The Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria indicates that there should be only one police force. Therefore, we have the Nigeria Police Force. Any other organizations or any other arrangement that deals with prevention of crime, passing information, creating intelligence, is just supporting the activities of the Nigeria Police. Before the Amotekun you are talking about, many states have created the vigilantes,
yes,
in order to support the Nigeria Police personnel to do their job. And what do? Vigilantes created in every state, whether you call it a vigilante or you call it forest guard or you call it gate guards or a motor cone or whatever, they are all vigilante groups that are supposed to be working within the communities, generate intelligence or pass information to the police, and when there is an imminent threat to security within the area, the police will go and intervene with the support of this vigilante group so as to nip on the bud the impending problem. So their work is to support the police, not to do police work, because constitutionally they don't have the power to do the police work. So no conflict per se, but they are not supposed to carry arms. Then any weapon, offensive weapon, they are not supposed to carry. Anywhere they want to intervene, those vigilante groups, and as they need to go with arms, then the police will be part of them, and the police will carry arms.
Will be the ones carrying
arms. Yes, because any of them carrying arms will be an illegal act. So if you are created to support the police to fight crime, to maintain law and order, and you yourself you are found to be committing crime by carrying arms illegally, then it becomes a problem.
IG, 2020 was a tough year for the police. The NSAS thing was the youth. Essentially, it was a youth-driven protest. And the agitation was based on, as you pointed out, not the entire police force, but just a few people within the SARS units, as they identified. I don't know if the IG has been following some of the testimonies at some of the panels set up in some of the states. as a result of this, and some of the things that some of the witnesses, some of the people there have come out, they name people, officers and men of the police by name, areas, you know, and so on, and they have evidence. They present evidence in many instances of what had happened. Some are running back 2, 3, 4 years ago. While one concedes that what they did, what some people did to police officers was very bad, are you going to engage them in such a way that they also believe that those people who did those things, or who allegedly did those things in many of the instances, are not just going to be let off the hook? So that there's some level of engagement between the police and the young ones, who incidentally will probably be the best sources of information for the police about potential crime.
Well, engagement of the youth from the police side is a constant engagement. We do it every day. We have different fora where we engage the youth in different activities. We have a program called COCACOF that deals with cultism in the southern part of the country. We have different initiatives. As I told you, I've created a forum of, at this level, at the first secretary's level, and at the commissioner of police level, all the civil society organizations that we have, including the youth, they will meet constantly to assess police activities, how we give our services, where there are challenges, how we can collectively address. We can confirm from the executive secretary of the National Human Rights Commission. He comes with some leadership of civil society organization. We've replicated that at the state level. So it is constant engagement that we do. The youth that you are talking about, who even participated in the NSAS and the rest of them, many of them want to join the police. Believe me, many of them will come
would,
and say,
that would be a happy ending to what is otherwise.
Many of them will come and say, please, we want to join the police. Because police is, the service the police provides is a service of God, you know. So those ones that the panel have identified, I think it is there for the panel to come up with recommendations on how to deal with them. It might not be even the police that will implement the recommendation. It might be a different body altogether. So I don't think that those found wanting will be let to go like that.
As IG, your predecessors, virtually every IG in the last decade, 2 decades, one of the things they say is checkpoints should be abolished. They say so, and I personally have witnessed the dismantling of some by the special squad attached to your office in some states. But then you come across others, and when someone in my position, for example, says, what are you doing here? The IG has said no checkpoints. They say I should bring the signal that came from the IG that said so, in some instances. Why is it so difficult for the order that comes from you at the very top to be implemented across board at the bottom?
When an order is given from the top, it must be complied with. Anybody that doesn't comply with will have to face the music, because police is a regimented organization. Instruction is given and you must carry it on. No checkpoint. Up to today, checkpoints in terms of roadblocks are banned. Any police officer that engages in that is doing an illegal duty, and if he's caught, he will answer for it. What we have is, we call it stop and search. While you are on patrol and you suspect a group of people or vehicle, then you stop them, ask questions. If you want to search, if you think there's any incriminating item in the vehicle, search. If you don't see anything, they pass. But idea of standing on the road and putting tires or putting sticks to block the road is no more. Anybody found doing that is committing an offense. And we have monitoring unit that goes around to check compliance. But we want also members of the public to help us check compliance. When you come to any place and you see a roadblock, and not stop and search, and no justification for it, video it and pass it. We have a complaint office under the PRO's office. It's online. You can video it and upload it there. The moment we see it, we will locate the place and take care of the unruly officers there. We've just, after this answers, we stopped and withdrew police officers that are attached to unauthorized persons.
And those we call VIPs.
Exactly, those you call VIPs. And we're implementing that to the fullest. We've been receiving reports that some people are seen with officers up to now. The only thing is, when we get such calls, we say, video them. Video them and send to us. And the moment that is done, we trace the officers, because every police officer that you see has an identity. From his uniform and from his location, we know the command he comes from, we know from the unit he comes from, we fish him out and punish him. And many people have been punished like that. And that's why you see the level of compliance is very high now. Because thank God to this social media something. Sometimes the social media creates more problems. Yeah, it can be useful, but it creates more problems than the solution.
Before we started, you were wearing your mask, I was wearing mine. We took them off for the purposes of this interview.
Yes.
And that was because of COVID-19. In several areas of the country, in compliance, in enforcing compliance with COVID-19, the police gets involved. But then you find that the police itself that is enforcing compliance, they are not wearing masks.
Yes, which is very wrong, because apart from the medical personnel, the next group of people that are vulnerable are the police officers, because we enforce the rules. In every command, from the beginning, we had intervention from different organizations supporting the police with hand sanitizers, masks, and the rest of them. And we distributed them to all the commands. So we believe that every police officer should have series of masks with him or with her when they're performing their duties. But it baffles us to see that they don't use it. Though sometimes for some people, for health reasons, it's so difficult for them to use the mask. But then, putting the mask for some minutes, especially when you are coming close, I mean, coming in close contact with an individual, wouldn't irritate you or cause you much problem. So we have distributed a lot of these COVID-19
PPEs.
Yes, to all our officers, all the commands. We are fumigating all the commands all over the country, and then giving all the sanitizers, the masks, and all that is. Up to now, we are doing it on constant basis, because we are getting intervention from federal government, from NGOs, from other organizations. So I think it's not a one-off thing. It's a continuous process. We expect our officers to be wearing it. But if they don't wear it, then they are risking their lives.
What's the police policy now on people with gunshot wounds? Because severally, you reach a hospital and they say, go and bring a police report. We won't treat this
person. No, we don't do that. We don't do that. Save life first. Even if an officer, I mean, if an individual, whether it's a robber, suspected armed robber, or kidnapper, or bandit, and he got a gunshot, he goes to the hospital, his life must be saved first before thinking of any other thing to do. There is no issue of asking for a police report before you treat anybody with gunshots.
Allow me to offer our sympathies for the policemen lost just recently, who were ambushed while on official duty.
Yeah.
We had a report of about 18 of them who were kidnapped. Have those all been rescued?
I don't think any policeman was kidnapped. As you see, this social media of a thing again is causing problems for everybody. Somebody would sit down, get a story, and write without cross-checking. We expect when you get a story, you say, okay, let me ask, which is in your profession is fair to ask the other side of the panel. Our officers went on duty. They finished at 2 of duty, they were going back, and they were ambushed. When they were ambushed, luckily they were all armed. They engaged the bandits, and they inflicted a lot of injuries, and we have casualties from the side of the bandits. And the police officers, all, I think we lost four, while the rest came out safely and then left. Now, people are talking of the attack on the police, but they didn't ask us of the casualties inflicted on the bandits. You know, the bandits, we have intercept on our platform of their communication. Our police became so wicked they killed them. But you are the one that attacked the police. You are saying police are so wicked they killed many of you. And we lost four people there. So it wasn't the issue of kidnap. It was an issue of ambush, and we engaged them. And then, unfortunately, we lost four people.
You have had a very eventful tenure, Inspector General. You've had a very eventful tenure. Quite a lot of things have happened while you were here as IG, the 20th. When you joined the police, what was your ambition then, in 1986?
When I joined the police?
Why did you join the police?
Well, I joined the police to contribute my quota of making sure that Nigeria becomes a peaceful country. When we were in schools, secondary schools, for example, we were seeing cases of theft of fouls, or bicycles are stolen, and you identify those group of people that are notorious in stealing bicycles, in stealing fouls, and the rest of it. And you get annoyed. You say, how can this guy, is known, his family is known, but he's still into this kind of a thing. And I didn't like it. And then I kept on up to when I went to university. Also, I saw the need for having a peaceful environment for you to achieve what you want to achieve. And university setting was so very peaceful, so calm. And after graduating, I felt that what kind of job can I do for it to be very impactful to the society? First, what came to my mind was Air Force. And when they asked me, why do you want to join Air Force? I said, I just want to be a jet bomber. I want to just be a pilot and then go and see where bad guys are. Let me drop bombs.
Bombs on them.
And then later I said, no, I think police is far better, because when you see tips were in my mind. I didn't know robbers or whatever, no. If you're able to take a thief out of the society, you are helping the society. So essentially, just to make sure that contribute my quota to see that in our societies we don't have bad guys. And I'm so lucky that when I joined, we had a very good teachers in the training school. We had people like late Amadou Shedu, who was a tough guy, disciplinarian. We had a Hindero, who became also IG as our teacher. Many other serious-minded and well-educated people that taught us. We felt we went with degree, and we went. Well, during the training, we saw people that had better degree than ours in the police teaching us. And I'm one of the luckiest persons in the police, in the Nigeria police, because I became the first Nigerian police officer to have worked at International Criminal Police Organization, Interpol, in France. I went there as a superintendent, and I was attached to Economic and Financial Crime Directorate. There, what we were doing core police duties to help fight crime all over the world, because cases will be reported all over the world, and it comes. There were many, it comes to our decks. We synthesize, we exploit the messages, make them in a format that will bring out the facts of the case, bring out the individuals involved, entities involved, put it in the database for other members of the Interpol community to have access, just to link the cases. If this case is reported from Cote d'Ivoire, maybe the crime has link with Japan, so we'll be able to link and then bring the cases together. From there, I grew up. I became a senior officer, assistant director in charge of subdirectorate. And with my performance, I became a director.
You became a big man.
I began, of course.
I'm using your phrase.
Yes, of course. First African, for that matter, to become a director in the history of that organization. As of that time, Interpol was about 80-something years old. Never had an African, not to talk of a black African. So I became a director. And a director of not any directorate, a very big directorate. It was called Directorate of National Central Bureau and I-247. National Central Bureau means all the Interpol of members, all Interpol members in the world. That time we had about 190 something members, and in every country you have what is called National Central Bureau. In Nigeria, we had it, in Japan, in United States. So those national central bureaus were reporting to me. So all over the world, I was taking care of the functionalities of those their offices all over the world. And then we had I-247, which is still the means of communication, a secured internet global communication system that one country will report a case to another country through that platform. Very secured. Nobody can have access to it except police organizations of those countries. Even within the police organizations, not everybody can have access except you are cleared. It was also under me. So I had a very big directorate that I managed. Well, I managed it for about 5 years before I came back to Nigeria. So I was very lucky Nigerian when I joined the police.
As we wind this up, I must ask, of course, there have been speculations everywhere about the fact that you assumed the office of Inspector General just over 2 years ago, 2 years and about 4 days ago. And there are now thoughts about transitioning. Would you perhaps, as someone suggested to me a couple of days ago when I said it was quite possible I'll be talking to you, that you might be going to open a big farm in Nasarawa after you stop being a police officer?
Well, my plans, I have a farm even right now. Not that I'll open, I have a farm. But my plan is beyond that. I think I will go back into international policy because I have the outreach all over the world. And my thinking is to just go back and do international policy up to a certain level of time and then relax. I have a lot to offer, not just because I finished as IG in Nigeria, so I just go back and sit down in Nasarawa State and life here. No, I have other things to do for the world.
I can only wish you the very best, Inspector General of Police Mohammed Adamu. Thank you for your time.
Thanks. Thanks for having me.
That's today's episode of Newsnight. Do let us know what you think of the issues raised by getting in touch using the various social media handles on your screen. I'm Ladi Akeredolu Ale. Thanks for watching and goodbye.